395 and your hymnal 395. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love. Let's all stand together if you would. 395 on that verse together. I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. It's a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love. I love the Christ who died on Calvary, for he washed my sins away. He put within my heart a melody, and I know it's there to sing. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love. 'Twill be my endless theme in glory, with the angels I will sing. 'Twill be a song with glorious harmony, when the chorus of heaven ring. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love.
All right, good singing this morning. Welcome to the morning service. Good to see everybody here today. And thanks for making the effort, getting up and coming out, being in church this morning, and looking forward to a great time together today. Let's bow for prayer together, shall we? Father, thank you for another Lord's Day you've blessed us with. And thank you, Lord, for the health and strength we have to be here this morning. Lord, I do thank you for each one who's made the effort to be here and to be in the service. And Lord, I know no one is here by accident. You knew exactly who would be present in the service today. And you know what each of us need in our heart. And I pray you'd minister to our hearts today as only you can. Lord, bless the music. Bless the fellowship together. Honor the preaching of the Word of God. May your will be done in each and every heart and life is my prayer. And we ask you to work. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Are washed away. I know a place where night is turned to day. Burdens are lifted, blind eyes made to see. There's a wonder-working power in the blood of Calvary. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Although found I know nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing this I plead, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
This is all my hope and peace,
nothing but the blood of Jesus.
This is all my righteousness.
righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Would you turn with me to number 50 in your hymnal, number 50? There's power, wonder-working power in the blood. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Let's sing that first together.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
On that last,
would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, there is power, there is wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
All right. Listen now, some announcements for us. Our schedule tonight, 5:30 Christian Growth Class. We'll be talking about why we use the King James Bible, all right? We had last week's lesson on the Bible and where the Bible came from, and now oftentimes when people come to visit, they realize we use the King James Bible and they want to know why. We'll explain that to you tonight, 5:30 in the Christian Growth Class. That's right across from the nursery in downstairs. And then tonight, 6:30, Lord willing, I'm going to talk to you tonight about the greatest title of all. What's the greatest title of all? Well, check that out tonight. I'll give you a hint. It's not CEO or CFO, okay? Just so you know, that's not what it is. But you come tonight, I think it'll be a blessing to you. Right after the service this evening, we'll have a meeting of all those who'd like to help in Vacation Bible School. That's coming up July 11 through 14. And so we'd like to meet with you if you'd like to be a part of that in some way. We can use the workers, and it'll get a great blessing by working VBS week. It's Monday through Thursday, July 11 through 14. All right, now, coming up this next Saturday, July 2nd, we'll have a church picnic at Windsor Park in Grove City, and you sign up for that downstairs and follow the directions. We're providing the meat that you're going to eat, hot dogs and hamburgers and such, but there's other things for you to sign up and bring. And that starts at 4 o'clock. If you want to come a little bit early, that's fine. We'll have volleyball set up and cornhole set up, and there's tennis courts there, and a nice playground for the kids, and a lot of things to do there. And so you're welcome to come out early and enjoy a little bit of time with church family, all right? Have a great time together at our July 4th picnic, all right? Next Sunday is All-American Sunday, and we want to, as usual, see how many states we can have represented on that day. I think we've had as many as 23 or 27 represented before. You just come represent the state in which you were born, all right? And we'll look forward to a great time together. Good patriotic music next Sunday, and it'll be a blessed time. So come next Sunday. Invite someone to come with you and be part of that service next Sunday morning. You'll enjoy that. All right? I think that's what I have for right now. Let's take a moment and welcome our guests tonight, this morning. Anybody here today for the very first time? Anybody? Thanks. Hey. Good to see Pat back here. Haven't seen Pat for a while. Glad he's back. And Jay, how about that? Good to see you, brother. And he's a over-the-road trucker now, I think. And I get to see posts from all over the country when he's around. But you look great, brother. It's good to see you this morning. Wonderful. Amen. All right. Let's hear from the choir.
Would you turn with me, please? If you from sin are longing to be free, look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God, 287. Let's sing that first together. If you from sin are longing to be free, look to the Lamb of God. He to redeem you died on Calvary. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. For he alone is able to save you. Look to the Lamb of God. When Satan tempts and doubts and fear assail, look to the Lamb of God. You in his strength shall over all prevail. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. For he alone is able to save you. Look to the Lamb of God. As we sing that last together, let's have the children go out to junior church. Children, you're dismissed to junior church. Let's sing that last. Fear not when shadows on your pathway fall. Fear not when shadows on your pathway fall. Look to the Lamb of God. In joy or sorrow, Christ is all in all. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. Look to the Lamb of God. For he alone is able to save you. Look to the Lamb of God. Amen. That's great singing this morning. Let's go over to 275. 275. It is well with my soul. Would you stand with me as you find 275? When peace like a river, on that first together. When peace like a river attendeth my way. When sorrows like sea billows roll. Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing those last two stanzas together. Sing that chorus with me, please. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul. My My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin, not in part but the whole, was nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Let's sing that third together. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when the face shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul.
Amen. Good singing. You may be seated. I hope it's well with your soul this morning. Amen. It shall be well if you give God what's His, amen. And don't rob God, and give cheerfully. The Bible says God loveth a cheerful giver. Now be assured He'll accept it from a grouch, but He loves a cheerful giver, and we ought to cheerfully give. God's been so good to each one of us, and you realize how good God's been when you go to another country. You see how some of the other folks in this world live, and what they how blessed we are in the United States of America. And so let's give as God has prospered us, each one of us, and we'll ask God's blessing on our giving this morning. Brother Abrams, lead us in our prayer, if you would.
Lord, our Heavenly Father, we come to your throne once again as the undeserving sinners that we are, and Lord, we ask that you bless this offering, you bless each giver and each gift, and you multiply it as you see fit, Lord. And Lord, now we ask that you bless our pastor, and we ask that you bless the message, and we thank you for your word, Lord, and without it, we would truly be lost. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. Played every time I hear that song, I remember that that was Adam's favorite song. Jesus loves even me. Just thought I'd share that tidbit of truth with you this morning. Acts chapter 20, please. Acts chapter 20 for the scripture reading. Acts 20. We're going to read verses 22, and then I'll read 23, and then we'll finish together reading verse 24. Verse 24 will be our text verse this morning. Acts 20, and beginning on verse 22. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. And let's begin together on verse 22 of Acts chapter 20. Ready? And now, behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, save that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy, and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. And let's pray. Father, add your blessing now to the reading of our scripture here this morning. We thank you again, Lord, for the precious word of God. Lord, I don't know where we'd be if we didn't have copies of your word. Didn't know. I'm reminded of the many people in the world that gather together and they don't have the word of God in their language. We pray, Lord, you'll raise up laborers to complete that task. Everybody ought to know who Jesus is. Thank you for the word of God, and I pray, Lord, that each of us be prepared to give our careful attention to it today. Lord, use the special now and use it to minister to our hearts to put us in tune with thee. It's in Christ's name we ask it. Amen.
Like a blind man I wandered, so lost and undone. A beggar so helpless, without God or his son. Then my Savior in mercy heard and answered my cry. And oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Since Jesus passed by, since Jesus passed by. Oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Well, I can't explain it, and I cannot tell you why, but oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. All my yesterdays are buried in the deepest of the sea. That old load of guilt I carried is all gone. Praise God, I'm free. Looking for that bright tomorrow where no tears will dim the eye. Well, oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Since Jesus passed by. Since Jesus passed by. Oh, what a difference since my Jesus passed by. Well, I can't explain it, and I cannot tell you why, but oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Since Jesus passed by. Since Jesus passed by. Oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by. Well, I can't explain it, and I cannot tell you why, but oh, what a difference since Jesus passed by.
Our Father in heaven, we bow before you in prayer now. And Lord, we want to thank you for that truth that he just sang about. What a difference has been made in our life since Jesus passed by. Lord, what a change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. Lord, we're thankful that Jesus makes the difference. And I pray that you'd help us to understand that today as we look at this particular passage of Scripture this morning. Lord, I want to thank you again for the Word of God, and I pray that you'll use it to work effectually in those of us who believe this morning. And I pray, God, that your Holy Spirit would be at work in each heart and life as we give out your Word today. Lord, help us to fulfill our ministry with joy. And I pray that we would understand what can hinder us and keep us from doing that. Allow us to impact our world for Jesus Christ. Allow us to do what you've called us to do. So, Father, have your way now in this message this morning. Help me as I bring the message, and please help each individual as they listen. In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. How many of you remember the days when you had a car that ran on leaded gasoline? Remember those days? And used to put leaded gas in. And the truth is, as long as you filled it up with the leaded gas, it ran fine. Now, most of you know me, know that I'm no mechanic expert when it comes to cars. But I know this, that if I put the wrong kind of fuel in the car, you're headed for trouble. I understand, though, from what I've read, that if you put unleaded gas into a leaded engine, it will run for a while, okay? Maybe a tank or two, but then you'll begin to hear a knocking in the motor, begin to make noise, and eventually it'll ruin the engine, or you'll at least have a breakdown. And if you want to speed up the process, try putting diesel fuel into a regular engine. It won't run very far on that. It very quickly will break down. And if you really want to mess things up, just pour some water in the gas tank. That'll go down really quick, and you'll be calling for the tow truck. But, you know, I think Paul brings out something here in Acts 20, and he's talking to the Ephesian elders, and he lets them know what is coming. He's saying, in verse 22 in your Bible, I'm going bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, save or except that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. All I know is Holy Spirit said, bonds and afflictions are waiting for me when I get there. I don't know what form that'll take. I don't know what all that means. But he says, I'm not concerned about that. Because he said, verse 24, none of these things move me. I don't care about any of that. Because, he said, I don't even count my life dear unto myself so that I might finish my course with joy. And the ministry which I've received of the Lord Jesus to testify, the gospel of the grace of God. Finish my course with joy. Run the race that God has for me and be able to end it with joy. I think the right fuel that a Christian runs on is joy. That's what you need to have in your tank. Now, let's be sure about something. God has designed that each one of us serve Him. Nobody is saved to sit. Nobody is saved to soak. Let's be sure the Bible's clear. Every one of us are saved to serve Jesus Christ. Nobody is saved to tell other people how to serve. You're saved to serve. All right? Let's look at some scriptures. Hold your finger or put a piece of paper there in Acts 20 because we'll come back to that. But go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Would you turn there, please? 2 Corinthians chapter 4. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4 in verse number 1, the Apostle Paul writes, therefore, seeing we have received this ministry. As we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, hath shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. Paul says here, notice verse 1, we've received this ministry. Everybody who's saved has received a ministry. And that ministry here is taking the gospel to the lost. Every one of us is to be employed in that service. And that isn't, listen, that can be in a time slot on a Tuesday or a Thursday or a Saturday or whenever that you designate a time to go out. But the truth of the matter is, that's to be all the time, everywhere, every place we go, we're giving the gospel. But I want you to look over at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, just one page over. Most of you are familiar with this verse, 2 Corinthians 5:17. For if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, behold, all things are become new. So now you're born again. Now you're a child of God. But wait, and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us. Now wait, he gave us salvation in verse 17, but in verse 18, he's giving us something else. What else did he give us? He's given us the ministry of reconciliation. That ministry of reconciling others to God. So God is not just saving you so you can say, I'm saved, that's all that matters. Oh, no, no, no. He saved you so you could serve him. That's what matters. And you're to bring glory to him with your service. Now, so the devil, if he could, he would like to keep you from ever getting saved. If he likes to deceive people. He would like you to deceive yourself into believing you're saved, even when you're not saved. Believing you're okay when you're not okay. Talking to Brother Yoder and Brother Moreland, he said one of the challenges they have where they are is convincing people that they're lost. They just don't think they're lost. They're good people. They're kind people. They're religious people. It's hard to believe that I'm going to go to hell. I'm a good person. You see? But you have to understand, We people are lost. And so we have that ministry of reconciliation. And we've been given that, every one of us. Now, Satan would like to keep you lost. But if he can't keep you lost, if you break through that and you realize that you're saved and you've received Christ as your Savior, now he would like to keep you from ever ministering for him. And if he can't keep you from serving God, if he can't keep you from serving Christ, he will let you serve, but not have any joy in service. You know what hurts the cause of Christ? It hurts the cause of Christ when we have grumbling ministers, grumbling servants. We serve the Lord, but we run our course, but we don't do it with joy. It seems like we have many believers who are enduring the Christian life instead of enjoying the Christian life. And Jesus never intended for it to be that way. And I think it's because you have the wrong fuel in your gas tank. And the joy has to come from the Lord. Now, let me define joy for you. And this is a definition that came from the Reformers Unanimous. The joy is the cheerful, calm delight in a particular circumstance. I think it's a cheerful, calm delight in all circumstances of life. And why is that? Because God's in control. God's in control of my circumstances. That's why Paul said, and by the way, he'd had people try to convince him not to go to Jerusalem. No, don't go there. Remember, Agabus bound his hands and such. That's what they're going to do to you, Paul. You know what Paul said? None of that moves me. I have a cheerful, calm delight. I'm going to finish my course with joy. I don't even concern myself with that because God's in control of that. Now, the opposite of joy is something called frustration. I know that I'm not talking to anybody in this room who ever gets frustrated, but just in case you know somebody who would. Frustration is when you have an unhappy refusal in the circumstances of your life, where you get very ticked off. That's a deep Greek word, isn't it? Because of the things that's happening in your life. And I'm refusing, man, I'm upset. It shouldn't be this way. Why'd this happen? How come I have to go through this? What is going on? And that's a frustration. And that is, by the way, that's not a fruit of the Spirit. Joy is a fruit of the Spirit. And I think I see, and I've noticed, there's some believers who are running their course with frustration rather than running their course with joy. Paul says, I want to run my course with joy. The question this morning I want to ask you, listen carefully now. I'm not going to ask you this morning, are you serving the Lord? Though you should be serving the Lord. But the question I'm going to ask you this morning is, are you serving the Lord with joy? Are you finishing your course with joy? There once was a young boy who went to spend the week at his grandfather's farm. While walking around the farm, he started walking, noticed the chickens, and he looked at the chickens and he said, nope, they ain't got it. He went over to the colts where the young horses were in the field, and he looked at them and he said, nope, they ain't got it. He went to the pigs and he looked at the pigs and he looked real close and he said, nope, they ain't got it. He went through all the animals on the farm and said, nope, they ain't got it. Nope, they ain't got it. And then he went into the barn and he saw the old mule with its long face looking at him. And as he stood there, he started screaming. And he screamed for his grandfather. Grandfather, come quick! Grandfather, come quick! And grandfather finally come running to the barn. He said, what is it? What is it? What's wrong? He said, I found it. I found it. He said, what'd you find? Did you lose something? He said, no, Papa. I finally found an animal that has the same kind of religion you got. Don't have that kind of religion, my friend. Listen carefully. George Barna reports that over 70 million Americans today are struggling to find some meaning in life. Listen carefully. But he also found that over 50% of Americans struggle with some kind of depression. That'd be over, what, 175 million? Are there 350 million people in America? And that's perplexing. And by the way, in that number has to be a number of believers. Salvation doesn't start that way. Remember when you got saved? I've never met anybody yet. When you shake your hand and say, well, did you, when someone comes forward and they bring you up afterwards, say, well, did you make a decision today? I never had anybody yet say, yeah, I got saved. Huh? No, that isn't how you were when you got saved either, was it? Man, it was excitementville. It was happiness. It was joy. Man, the load is lifted from off you. That's the load of sin is gone. And there's great joy. I mean, you go through the scripture and you find out when Zacchaeus, the Bible says he received Jesus joyfully. There's great joy. When the eunuch believed in Christ with all his heart and Philip baptized him, the Bible says he went on his way rejoicing. When the jailer got saved and Mrs. Jailer and all the little jailers and they got baptized that in the middle of the night, they were rejoicing in God with all his house. Salvation starts and we're full of joy. Joy that we're saved. Joy, my sins are forgiven. Joy, my name's written down in heaven. Joy, I'm not going to hell. What happens? Where does the joy leak out? Where do we lose that joy? What robs us of the joy? What destroys that joy that we start with when we get saved? I want to talk to you this morning about some destroyers of joy. Some destroyers of our joy in our life. If you've lost your joy today, if you're serving God but you've lost your joy, you're going to look at one of these things we're going to touch on this morning as the culprit that has taken away your joy. Let me give you number one. The first destroyer of our joy is something called mediocrity. Mediocrity. Look at Matthew 5 with me, will you please? Matthew chapter 5. Matthew 5 is the beginning of what's called the Sermon on the Mount given by Jesus Christ. It takes up Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7. And Jesus, in the Sermon on the Mount, is setting a higher standard than what the Old Testament law ever set. The Old Testament law said that you shouldn't kill somebody. But Jesus said, I say unto you, if you hate your brother without cause, you're guilty of murder. The Old Testament said that you should not commit adultery. But Jesus raised that standard even higher, and he said, if you look on a woman and lust after her in your heart, you're guilty of committing adultery. A higher standard, always. In fact, let's look how high the standard was. Look at Matthew 5 and verse number 46. Matthew 5 and verse 46. Jesus said, if you love them which love you, what reward have ye? Do not even the publicans the same? And if ye salute your brethren only, what do ye more than others? Do not even the publicans so? Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. What do ye more than others? If there's anything, and there are many, many teachings you can get from the Lord's message here on the Sermon on the Mount, but I'll guarantee one of these is this. Jesus is not allowing his followers to settle for being average. Jesus is not going to allow his followers to settle for being mediocre. What do ye more than others? Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Listen, I'm saying that if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, good enough isn't good enough. Well, I'm cleaning the church. Well, I'm working nursery. Well, I'm cleaning the bus out. Or, well, I'm preparing for this. Well, it's not great, but it's good enough. Not when it comes to God's work, it isn't. God says, what do you more than others? The whole point is not to settle for average, not to settle to maintain, not to settle to just... It's always striving to be growing, always striving to be better, always striving to be improving. And we don't do that because growth isn't easy. Changing is hard. How do you change? How do you grow? Well, you do that by reading the Scripture. You do it by studying the Scripture. You do it by memorizing the Scripture, by meditating the Scripture, by observing to do the Scripture. You just do what you know God says you should do, whether you feel like doing it or not. You have to do what is right to do. I should be a better pastor now than when I started in 1982. I should be a better husband now than when I started in 1979. By the way, you should be a better bus worker now than you were when you started working on a bus. You should be a better Sunday school teacher now than when you started teaching Sunday school. You should be a better choir member now than when you started singing in the choir. Are you a better Christian now than you were this time last year? Why not? Why not? what destroys churches and what destroys individuals is being mediocre. Huh? Good enough. Yeah, I know. I only read my Bible 4 days this week. Oh, well. Nobody's perfect. And we begin to settle for mediocre. We begin to settle for average. And you lose your joy because you lose your drive. You lose your desire to be the best for the Lord. You lose that, you lose your joy. And Jesus is saying, let's rise above that. Let's rise above average. Let's rise above mediocre. Let's be the best we should be for God. In the Swiss Alps in Switzerland, there's a church graveyard near the base of a mountain. Among the numerous gravestones there in the graveyard is a special tombstone. It's a tombstone of a man who died while he was climbing on that mountain. And the only words on that tombstone besides his name are these words: he died climbing. He died climbing. Those aren't bad words to put on your tombstone. I want to die climbing. I want to die pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I don't ever want to be content. I want to live above the world, where Satan's darts at me are hurled. Oh, I want to plant my, I want to say, God, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to still be climbing when the Lord calls me home. Don't settle for being mediocre. The second thing that can destroy your joy and take away your joy is something called materialism. Materialism. The Bible says in Exodus 20 and verse 17, thou shalt not covet. One of the quickest things that'll take away your joy is when you wish for things that you do not have. And not just that. Not just wish for things you don't have, but you begin to think you're suffering because you don't have them. And it is easy, my friend, in America to get caught up with things. And Americans, those of you who were in Mexico, and we weren't in the poor of Mexico. We were in the city of Juarez, and you go further down and into the country areas, and that's where you'll see literally pallets of wood with just tarred paper hung over them, and nobody has a front door. It's just a piece of cloth hanging there. People live that way. You won't see in some of the places that we saw, we thought should have been condemned, and people were living in there. We're blessed. We have so many things. I think about every time I drive to our house, there's a huge storage facility by our house. I think of all the people that have those storage places just filled with stuff. That most of them, if you said, make a list of things you have in your storage shed, they probably couldn't even tell you what's in there. In fact, and there's so many people that have things in there, they end up just leaving them in there. They made a whole TV program out of that. Where people just sell the stuff that's in there. Why? The people accumulated stuff in there and then walked off and left. Things. Mark chapter 4, please. While you get Mark 4, flip over to Luke 8 as well and put your finger there in Luke 8. We'll read Mark 4, then we'll look at Luke 8. Materialism. In Mark 4, you have Jesus giving the parable of the sower. We know there are four different types of soil. Jesus gives the parable and then he explains the parable to them. And he gives in verse number 18 the third soil, which are these are sown among the thorns, verse 18 of Mark 4. And these are such as hear the word, and the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the lusts of other things entering in, And when the cares of the world, deceitfulness of riches, and lusts of other things enter in, what do they do to the word? Choke it out, and it becomes unfruitful. How many times do people say, you know, I didn't get to read my Bible this week, didn't get to do my devotion, I'm just too busy. Cares of the world, deceitfulness of riches, lusts of other things. Choked the word. Choked it right out of our life. And it bears no fruit. Again, Luke 8, same parable. This is how it's worded in Luke and his explanation there. They which fell among thorns, verse 14. Luke 8:14. They which fell among thorns are they which we have heard that go forth and are choked with cares and riches and pleasures of this life, and they bring no fruit to perfection. So easy to get caught up in the things of this life. And you can see it, by the way, we see it in churches. We see it as churches, they're not trying to so much the more as they see the day approaching. They're so much the less as they see the day approaching. We're not adding more services. We're cutting back on services. We're trying to see how little can I go to church and still be okay. Why? I got other things to do. What is it? Cares of this world. Chokes the word. No wonder we don't have fruit. No wonder we're not impacting our world for Christ. For Eve, it was the one tree that was forbidden. Desiring the one thing that God said you couldn't have instead of focusing and enjoying all the things she could have. Instead of looking at what you do have and what God has blessed you with and what God has given to you and being thankful for what you have, we only focus on what we don't have. And it consumes us. For Balaam, it was money. For Gehazi, it was clothes and gold. But the Apostle Paul said, whatever things were gained to me, that I counted loss for Christ. Friend, I know it's not popular in our society for somebody to preach like this. It's a whole lot easier to preach health and wealth. But it's not biblical. And we have seen a power failure in the church because the word is being choked by the things of this world. Don't let that happen. When that happens in your life, your joy is gone. I can't tell you the times I've talked to people who are so frustrated when they can't get to church because they just have so much to do. So much work to get done, so much thing. And by the way, the devil will see to it that he'll keep you busy. If he knows that's what will keep you away, he'll pile it on. You have to decide, I'm not going to get materialistic. If we live with less, we live with less. If we do without, we do without. But God's going to be first. Materialism, mediocrity. Let me give you the third one. Meditations. Psalm 19:14 says, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Don't nudge anybody. Don't look at anybody, but just think to yourself. I'm going to ask you a question. What do you think about? What do you think about? You tell me what you think about, and I'll tell you how you live. Because thinking determines living. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Proverbs 23:7. Guard thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. The issues of life are always issues of the heart. And by the way, you do your thinking in your heart, not that thing pumping in there, but the core of your being. Up here, you say, well, I got so much going on in my head. No, you got so much going on in your heart, in your innermost being. you store it all up here. Somebody says, well, I just speak my mind. No, you don't. You speak your heart. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Somebody says, well, if I think it, I say it. That's because you think it in your heart. And your heart, what's down in the well, comes up in the bucket. That's the way it works. So we store information in the head, but we meditate in our heart. So what do you think about? What occupies your mind? Idle moments, unplanned time, is always the devil and the flesh's playground. I didn't count the number of men in this room today. If there's 40 men in this room, statistics show that anywhere from 16 to 20 of those 40 men will struggle with pornography. Anywhere from 40 to 50% of the men in this room. It's so accessible. It's so easy. Listen to me. It will destroy you. It will destroy you. It will destroy your marriage. It'll destroy your relationships. Look at Romans 12 with me, would you please? Romans 12. Romans 12, you know, begins with giving our bodies as a living sacrifice and not conforming to the world. And then he talks about the gifts that God's given to every believer and how we work those gifts out in service for Him. And he gives plain, simple commands as we go through it. And then he's in verse 19, as he closes the chapter out, he said, "Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. And in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head." And then he gives an important principle here to wrap it all up. Verse 21. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. How do you overcome evil? With good. Okay, how do you overcome evil thoughts? With good thoughts. You don't overcome evil thoughts by saying, I'm not going to think about it, I'm not going to think about it, I'm not going to think. You know what you're doing? You're thinking about it. No, you flood your heart. You fill it with good thoughts. You fill it with good things. You fill up, you overcome the evil with good. Don't allow the idleness. The truth is, I know, it's man's favorite, one of their favorite sayings. Now, ladies, ladies, look at me. Those of you who are married, how many of you ever asked your husband, what are you thinking about? And he replied, nothing. Huh? Yeah. Now, that's not true. Okay? Now, to be sure, let me make sure we understand. To be sure, there is a difference between the way a man thinks and a woman thinks, okay? That's another sermon for another time, but just want to make that distinction. However, can I say that, listen, one of the worst things you can ever do is throw your mind in neutral. Those of you in this room, men who have struggled with impure thoughts and impure thinking, you will testify. You throw your mind in neutral and turn on the television. You throw your mind in neutral and throw on that computer, and I tell you what, you're playing right into the hands of the devil. That's why they call it amusement. Muse is to think. Ah means without. So when they call it amusement, it's without thinking. In other words, let that box, let that let that do the thinking for you. Boy, that's a bad place to go. A bad place to go. Don't let that happen. Stay busy with right thoughts. Overcome evil with good. Let me help you this morning, whether you're man or woman. Listen carefully. This is an important statement. Keep no secrets from somebody. Keep no secrets from somebody. If you're a husband or you're a wife, that ought to be your mate. There's no room in a marriage for you to keep secrets from each other. None. And you got to have somebody with whom you have no secrets. They can ask anything they want, anytime they want, and you will be honest. If you have an area of your life, if you have a part of your life that no one knows but you, you're in trouble. You're in trouble. You've bought into the lie of Satan. Don't let that happen. There's no substitute for moral purity. Don't lose that. What are you thinking about? What do you allow to capture your thoughts? Think on purpose, will you? That's why you ought to have memory verses. You ought to have verses that God speaks hard about and write them down on cards. Carry them with you or put them places where you see them. What is that doing? Putting your thoughts back on the Word of God. Giving you something to think about on a continual basis. Not just allowing yourself to whatever you hear on the radio, whatever you hear in the song, whatever I see on the billboard, whatever I hear over here somebody say, all of a sudden that grabs and captures my mind and I start thinking about that. I don't want someone else to determine my thoughts. Whenever you start to feel depressed or you get discouraged or you're feeling down or you're feeling tempted, you have to stop and think, what have I been thinking about? Examine what you've been thinking about, because as you think, that's what you'll do. And change your thinking. Mediocrity, materialism, meditations, number four. Maliciousness. You say, what? Look at 1 Peter chapter 2, will you please? 1 Peter chapter 2. Maliciousness is one of those words in the Bible we read and we read it over and we say, yeah, we got to put that way, that maliciousness or that malice. But if I probably asked most of you what the word malice means, most people couldn't really come up with a definition. You know it's bad. You know it's something bad, but you may not be able to explain exactly what it is. Let me tell you what malice is. Malice, in 1 Peter 2, verse 1, wherefore laying aside all malice, all guile, and hypocrisies, and envies, and all evil speakings. Don't you love it when God puts all there? So you can't wiggle free. Malice is harboring ill will toward another person. Harboring ill will toward another person. Wishing bad for somebody else. Now, I know nobody here has ever had that. But in case you know somebody that does, you might be able to help them. And let me say this. You usually wish bad for somebody. Usually will wish or harbor ill feelings toward somebody else when they have hurt you. You've all heard the expression, hurting people hurt people. And sometimes it's so good, Christian, if when someone is hurting you or they say something that hurts you or they try to lash out at you, if you just stop and say, you know what? They're hurting. I'm not going to take that personally. I'm not going to take that as me. They're a hurting person. And if you can get through that and still minister to them, they'll usually break down. Saul had the kingdom taken away from him. Do you think that hurt? Yeah. He did all he could to try to get it back. He said, okay, all right, I'm wrong. I've sinned. Now come sacrifice me. Man, let's reverse this. But he couldn't. God already had spoken. Saul was hurt. I believe he's deeply hurt. I believe somewhat embarrassed. He'll no longer be the king. When he was hurt and angry, he began to eye David. And he did what he harbored ill will toward David. David done anything wrong? No. Time and time again, you read 1 Samuel there, 2 Samuel, you'll find that David behaved himself wisely in the sight of the Lord. That's just God telling us. There was nothing David was doing. The problem was on Saul's end. He wished bad on David, and he was willing to carry it out. And Saul became an angry, frustrated, suspicious old man. Don't be a Christian like that. Don't be a Christian like that. Put off envy. Put off malice. Put off evil speaking. You have to put that off before you can put other stuff on. You can replace that, but you got to get rid of it. You have to lay it aside. Saul's malice towards David destroyed him. Haman's malice toward Mordecai destroyed him. Your malice toward whoever you think about when I mention that word will destroy you. Robbers of our joy. Mediocrity, materialism, meditations, maliciousness. Number five. I only have 76 of them, so just sit tight. I'm kidding. I have five. That's the last one. Number five is mankind. Is it mankind? Yeah, let me explain. Philippians 4:4. Who knows what that says? Rejoice in the Lord. Always, and again I say, rejoice. That means our joy is supposed to be in the Lord. But you know, some people live to get their joy from people. And if your joy is dependent upon people, you're in a world of hurt. A woman dreams for years about finding Mr. Right. She believes that man will fulfill her deepest longing for intimacy and companionship. She'll picture him sitting next to her on an overstuffed love seat in front of a warm fire. His arm around her, just talking for hours. No ball game, no computer, no TV. She envisions him always being there for her in her time of need, understanding and caring and loving. She just imagined that husband as somewhat of a waterfall cascading into her life, a never-ending source of fulfillment. Bring her happiness. But the woman who believes that is setting herself up for some real heartache. Because she's setting up a picture of her husband that can never be fulfilled. She finds out soon that those expectations are way off the mark. And he doesn't fulfill those expectations. That relationship that she thought would bring her joy and she thought would bring her fulfillment only brings her frustration and hurt feelings and unhappiness. But men will do the same thing. He'll picture marrying the wonderful woman, the perfect wife. Every day he'll come home and she'll comment how gifted as a man and a husband he is and how blessed she is to have him. She'll have a delicious meal prepared every night and always respond warmly to his physical advances, even when she's worked hard all day and maybe even chased after several children. Oh, and she'll love sports. She'll want to sit down and watch the sporting event every time he does. You'll find out that, as we said earlier in the message, you find out if it's that way for the wife or that way for the husband, you'll find out that's the wrong fuel to be putting into your engine. And pretty soon you'll sputter and you'll choke and you'll break down. By the way, it works that way for church too. You can't find your joy in church. Because if your joy is dependent on church and the people in the church, you find out that the people in the church aren't perfect. You don't have to go to this church very long to find out the pastor isn't perfect. You find out sometimes church leaders aren't perfect. And then people get so disillusioned. I think, what were you looking for? What were you expecting? You pinch this flesh too. And I'll just, if you're brand new to the church, just let me forewarn you. I'm sure I'll disappoint you. I don't want to. I'm not planning on it. But don't put your joy in me. Don't put your joy in the church. You'll lose your joy, and then that's why you run into people all the time. I used to go to church, but the preacher did this, or I used to go to church and the song leader did that, or I used to do this, and some you know, the church made this, and they're all upset because the church did something. And you know what? They're not smiling when they say that. Their joy's gone. They lost their joy because their joy is in the church. Your joy can't be with people. I have more I want to share with you here about Leah in the Old Testament, but I'll go through that and share it with that some other time. I'm saying is, wives, husbands, Christians, listen, no one else can give you the joy in life that only God can give you. You try to find that in anybody else, and you'll be sorely disappointed, you'll be frustrated, and you will quit serving God. Or you will continue to serve, but you'll be grumbling and complaining while you serve. You won't be a happy Christian. Jeremiah 2:13, listen carefully. God said, "My people have committed two evils. They've forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water." When he says, "They've forsaken me, the fountain of living water," a fountain is the source of what's necessary for life. And God says, they've forsaken me, and they've hewed out some other cisterns. They've gone other places and forsaken the one thing, the one source that gives them life. How sad. The source of our joy is the Lord. The source of our joy is God. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say rejoice. Now listen, joy in Christ requires a commitment of you to live as a Christian ought to live. Salvation is a gift. But you need to understand that if you're going to have the joy of salvation, it's going to demand some disciplined action. I read this quote this week. Most Christians have just enough of the gospel to make them miserable, but not enough to make them joyful. They know enough about the biblical message to keep them from doing the things the world tempts them to do, but they don't have enough of a commitment to God to do those things that would have them experience fullness of joy. I don't want enough of Christ just to not do what the world wants. I want to have enough of Christ that I do what He wants me to do and experience the fullness of joy that I'm supposed to have. I don't know about you. I want to be happy in the service of the King. I want to serve the Lord with gladness. I want to have joy as I run my course. Joy unspeakable and full of glory. That's how I started this race. That's how I started the course. That's how you started the course. Let's finish the course that way. Talking to people today, you've lost your joy. And one of these five areas is the culprit. Maybe more than one. What you need to do is you need to bring that to God. Say, God, forgive me. Let me find my joy in you. Let me get back to where it's you and me. And you start every day with you and God. I'd encourage you to end every day with you and God. Keep your joy. Don't let the mediocrity, don't let the materialism, don't let the meditations, don't let the malicious, don't let those ill feelings, those bad feelings towards someone else, don't let that rob you of joy. Don't let your joy be in somebody else and dependent on them. Let your joy be in the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord always. I want to finish my course with joy. Let's pray, shall we? Father, take the truth now this morning. Thank you for the attention of everyone today. A little bit longer today than normal, but God, it's been on my heart. And I pray, Lord, you'd help us to finish our course with joy. You've given us the joy of the Lord. Father, I pray that others would see that joy, that we serve the Lord with gladness, that the joy of the Lord will be our strength. And Lord, I'm praying that if we've allowed some of these things to take over our life and it's taken away our joy, hurt our testimony, hurt our influence upon others, not that we're not serving the Lord, but we serve the Lord and we grumble and we complain. Forgive us. Forgive us. Give us that cheerful, calm delight in the circumstances of our life. For you are the author of those circumstances. Take us away from the frustration that comes as a result of these destroyers of our joy. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I'll finish the prayer in just a moment. I wonder how many folks in the room this morning would say, Pastor, if I died this morning, I know for sure that I would go to heaven. There's a time in my life when you talked about that joy of being saved and that joy of knowing Christ your Savior. I know that joy, Pastor. I experienced that when I got saved. And Pastor, here's my hand as a testimony. I know that I'm saved this morning. Would you slip your hand up for a moment that I may see it? I know I'm a Christian. Okay, you may put it down. You're here today and would say, Pastor, I don't know for sure. If I died, if I'd go to heaven. I don't know that I've ever experienced that joy of salvation you spoke about. Pastor, would you pray for me today? Would you slip your hand up now and say, Pastor, pray for me? Is there somebody like that this morning? All right. Believers, let me ask you this. How's your joy? Now, I didn't ask if you're serving. What I'm asking, are you serving with joy? Didn't ask if you're finishing your course, but are you finishing your course with joy? I wonder how many folks today would say, Preacher, one of those destroyers, one of those robbers has robbed me of my joy, and I'm going to give it back to God today. I'm going to ask God to forgive me. And by His grace, I'm going to finish my course with joy. Pastor, God spoke to my heart this morning. Will you slip your hand up, Christian, and say, pray for me? Yes. Yes. Amen. That's good. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. God has spoken to your heart this morning. Now it's time for you to respond to Him. Whatever it is He's told you to do, you obey Him today. You'll be glad you did. There's great joy when you do what the Spirit prompts you to do. Heavenly Father, have your way now in this invitation. Thank you for speaking to our hearts today. And I pray, Lord, that the decisions that have been made, you've spoken to people, they'll respond to what you've asked them to do. They'll bow the knee to you and yield. And Lord, give them their joy. Help us to finish our course with joy. What a good advertisement that is. We said in Sunday school, other people ought to see the goodness and grace of God upon our lives. Bring that to us, God. Let us know what it is to serve the Lord with gladness. Have your way now in every heart and life, and I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. As he sings the invitation, God has spoken to your heart. Respond to him this morning. Will you please?
Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled?
That's right.
No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting, He passed and we follow Him there. Over us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. His word shall not fail you, He promised. Believe Him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, His perfect salvation to tell. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Look this way for a minute, if you would, please. You know, life goes by quickly. It doesn't matter what age you are, you can't hardly believe you're the age you are. You ever felt that way? And those of you who weren't here Wednesday night, we were scheduled to have missionary Bob Johnston with us, and we found out on Tuesday that he was killed in a car wreck on June 1st. And he's missionary Haiti and Dominican Republic for 27 years. Got a letter on my desk from his son-in-law talking about there's 25 churches he planted and established in those 27 years. All of them have national pastors, all of them self-supporting, all of them continuing on for the glory of God. That's a missionary, brother. That's someone who did the job for Christ. You know, how much money did he make in his lifetime? What kind of house did he live in? What kind of car did he drive? What kind of clothes did he wear? Did he have a motor home and a boat? What kind of vacations did he take? Does any of that matter? Only one life, so soon it will pass. Only what's done for Christ will last. When you're gone, when I'm gone, they're not going to remember, oh, remember the house they lived in? Remember the car they drove? Remember the clothes they wore? But sure, it'd be nice to say, remember the people they witnessed to? Remember the folks they led to Christ? Remember the encouragement they were? You see, what you do for Christ is what lasts. Let's serve the Lord with gladness. It's the only life there is. Amen? I'm glad I'm saved. Hope you are too. Let's pray, shall we? Father, thank you so much for your goodness to us. Thank you, Lord, that we get to serve you and we get to serve you with joy. What an honor. What a privilege. Thank you for so great a salvation that you provided in Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, for desiring to use us. And Lord, I pray now that you'll dismiss us with your care. Take us from this place, Lord, and help us to live the Bible we've learned this morning. Help us to be doers of the word and not hearers only. And Lord, I pray that the joy of the Lord would show on our faces. And others would see the happiness and the joy that we have in Christ. Lord, I pray that it would be a great witness and a testimony to others. Your goodness and your grace in our lives. Give us a good afternoon and then bring us back this evening for the evening services. Lord, I pray that everyone will be faithful and be in their place on Sunday night. And I'll thank you for it. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God, Brother Bob.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You're dismissed. We'll see you tonight.